And could we perhaps develop a core humanitarian standard? The answer to that was yes. It took a few years. It took a couple of thousand conversations with many of you and many others. But the result is this, and I think I can summarize much of the morning with ta-da! That was it, right? I really liked the enforcement we got. First, the slideshow here of what organizations said about it, then some of the people who spoke, and the video message from Yasmin of Save the Children. I really liked Jane Cocking's comment that this was clarity, coherence, and communication exemplified. Now that is cool stuff. Now, of course, it's a little bit like asking people what they think about Justin Bieber at a Justin Bieber concert, because you wouldn't be here if you didn't like it. There was a statement yesterday made by 8 French NGOs who did not think it was such a good standard. So it's not as if the entire world is now aligned behind the CHS. Having said that, there seem to be a lot of people behind it, and these people matter. And I'm not just talking size, I'm talking credibility. So that was all good. Then the rest of the morning was about the follow-up, and that follow-up is significant. As some people said, the work had only just begun. The follow-up starts, of course, with the guidance notes, because we've got now a potentially verifiable standard, but it's not actually verifiable yet, because there is not the indicators and the parameters that are going to be captured by the guidance note to actually guide that verification. And the steering committee of this will overlook it at a strategic level, but it won't be the ones doing the work. That would be you again, and again, many other people. And next important step, once that guidance note set has been produced, is that these three organizations that stood as sort of an incubator role here are going to drop their own standard. That's quite a big deal. So the people in 8 Code of Good Practice, the HEP standard, the Sphere Core standards are all things that we developed in the course of many years and then utilized in many years, found useful in many ways, and now we're going to dismantle. That is quite a big deal. Moreover, HEP and people in 8 are then going to merge, also quite a big deal. We're both financially healthy, we're doing okay, yet we're merging for the strategic reason of it making more sense in the context of CHS. Now, not an easy decision that is, but it's going to be, it has been made. And what was I talking about? Merger, big deal. But of course, that is only the inward navel-gazing kind of big deal. The really big deal is that this now needs to be incorporated, integrated in all these other standards, mechanisms, systems, and processes. So a lot past the venue today. The United Nations, the fact that they came, the fact that Mrs. Gui flew in from New York to give that opening presentation and then flew out again in the afternoon, quite a big deal, quite a sign. I walked with her to the metro to make her say something about the UN will incorporate this into its practice, but I couldn't. But she did emphasize, well, I did come. That is quite a sign from New York to here to endorse the core humanitarian standard. That is not a triviality. And then Loretta went a step further and said, we've got these interagency standing committee transformative agenda. And that is also about accountability for affected populations, but it's different people. We need to make sure that we work together, that we get the same kind of set of indicators so that the one and the other are actually aligned. Same with the cluster system. Same with the national humanitarian framework, accountability frameworks. Same with the national legislation and policies that the Mexican ambassador was referring to. And of course, same with the NGOs. That is what I'm least concerned about, because there already is so very much support. it does yet have to prove itself, though. The donors, I'm concerned about that as well, because what I'm hoping for is not just a system where they endorse it. What I'm hoping for is not an extra layer of bureaucracy. What I'm hoping for is that as NGOs sign contract with donors, you always have all these conditionalities and they're always slightly different and cumbersome. Maybe they could be simplified and be based on the core humanitarian standard. Wouldn't that be useful? That is quite different. That is quite different from saying we will only give money to people who have been externally verified and certified. I'll come to that in a minute. Then once we've integrated it all, we actually have to implement it, to actually make it happen. And yes, it needs to be locally contextualized, etc. But as was pointed out, this does not include sexual harassment, you know, depends on the circumstances. No, there are bottom lines. People need to be at the center in whatever way you contextualize it. So CHS still has quite a way to go in terms of the guidance notes, in terms of making it integrated, in terms of making it actually happen in a contextualized yet consistent manner. And once all that happened, we have to do it again, because it's a living tool. We have to revise it. And again, not something the steering committee can do by itself. It's something that the entire humanitarian sector needs to stand behind. That was the morning. Then in the afternoon with the SCHR, it started with a presentation from Kate and Philip that essentially said this. We have conducted a lot of research. The findings of this research is that external verification and certification can be useful. With lots of provisos, but it can be useful. We therefore are going to push for that, and we have timelines for this. We need your help to advocate, promote, and actually make it happen. Am I saying it right? Thank you. We then had a table discussion, and that was rather more mixed than in the morning. So in the morning, everybody was, yay, this is great. In the afternoon, people had some sort of practical concerns, you know, the timeliness. Do we really have the CHS tools in place to be able to certify in the next few months? Can you really certify a couple of hundred organizations in just a few years? Then you had the more fundamental choices. Do you need to be in the global north or perhaps possibly in the global south? But most of it was about this paradox. If you're not successful as the SCHR, as the external verification and certification body, if you're not successful, and these are the ones that are certified, and these are the ones that are not certified, then it is truly voluntary. It's also kind of irrelevant. If, on the other hand, you're successful, and you do indeed manage to have a couple of hundred organizations certified, and the group of non-certified agencies becomes progressively smaller, you've been very successful, but it's less voluntary. And it's the same with the funding, I think. If this is the worldwide funding pot, and Danida says, well, for Danish NGOs, we would insist on certification, it becomes slightly less voluntary. But if then other donors follow, and after a while, this is the donor group that insists on certification, and the voluntary agencies need to fish in this pool, is really no longer voluntary. So these are quite fundamental issues that need to be resolved. I think that the title of this thing is overambitious. I don't have recommendations here. I just think there is a paradox that needs to be studied and a way forward must be found. Thank you.
This microphone here. I'll start off by saying a big congratulations to all of you. I mean it, we mentioned it a couple of times this morning, we really need to celebrate today, and I mean it because it's a big achievement. Maybe you do not all recognize it, but I can just give you my own feeling. I touched upon it last night. I've been around for 4.5 years in this field now, And we put out money for the joint implementation or joint standards initiative. And when we had the conference in Copenhagen 1.5 years ago, I thought, this is going to be it. Now I'm going to be presented with a nice, good and solid document. But we were not quite there. But today we are here with a full document, and I'm really amazed with the level of support in this room and the backing for it. It's good. It's something we all can be proud of, especially those who work for it, which I'll come back to in the end. The Common Humanitarian Standards consist of the 9 commitments and the 9 quality criteria. And I think we can easily live up to them. I was sitting next to Ocha also, and I said, all of the UN agencies can buy into this. And there was no reason why not. And she agreed. So I think it's a matter of a process where you have done a lot of hard work now preparing this one, and we need to make sure that it's fit into other processes, which I will also come back to. We are all here because we believe that the humanitarian assistance that we provide can improve and be better for the people out there. And that is also what the Common Humanitarian Standards is about. So let's keep that in mind, I think. I want to give you a few takeaways, and I will call these takeaways my own, not to say that I have put the words in your mouth or whatever, but some of my observations. First one is that seems to be a lot of appreciation for the work that has been done here. There seems to be a lot of backing for the Common Humanitarian Standard. And as Loretta said for Mocha when she left, Aina, this has come to stay. I can feel it. So we better work on it in the UN system as well. We still need some work to be done. William touched upon it before. He talked about the guidance notes and indicators and so on. We heard it this morning also. And the people behind it presenting it said it will be done in the first quarter of 2015. And I'm very glad to hear that, because this has been a long process. I mean, I remember 4 years of it. An old colleague of mine, Nils Stabelstein, in the room here also, he said this started 16 years ago with the Rwanda evaluation, and now we're getting there with a common humanitarian standard. So I'm glad we'll have this done in the first quarter and be able to move from there, because really, if we are to live up to the common humanitarian standards, whether it's going to be just the standards or certification part for those who would like to do that, they need to be there. They need to be there as a full framework. We need to work on a broad buy-in among NGOs, among UN organizations, governments, donors, because also donors look different at it, as many of you do in this room here today. So there's still work to be done before this is the standard for principle to humanitarian assistance. And I think it can be, because you've put a lot of work into it, and to me it looks really good. Now, let's move on to the afternoon and voluntary external certification. Let me first of all state, I'll be the first one to say it must be voluntary. I know many of you also feel when the Danish minister is quite tough, saying at least the Danish NGOs getting a lot of money must be certified, then it's a different story. But forget about that, please, for a second. And let's look at it. We're looking at establishing a voluntary system. Today, there were many pros and cons. I heard many of them. I hear often the concern, what about the local NGOs? What about the small NGOs? There's never been the intention, at least from our side, to push for them to be certified. I am also concerned about those who are already certified. We cannot create such a wonderful tool here and not allowing organizations to be certified against it. That would be like stopping date halfway and not going in. So I think we owe it to move forward on that. It's going to cost some money. I've been talking to a number of the donors, and my feeling is that once we have a proposal on the table for how to take such a certification mechanism forward, there will also be some donors that will be prepared to support that. And I'll be make sure that we also there'll be money in there for those who are small NGOs or weaker to, if they wish to certify, there'll be help, there'll be assistance to take that route also. But I think it's important we do it. Now there's concern about the roadmap. For any process you need to set up and do, you need a roadmap. Some people said it's ambitious. I like it when it's ambitious. I mean, my hope was that this common humanitarian standard would have been around a year and a half ago. But I also acknowledge that the work put into it in the last year or so has been very valuable. So, I mean, it's a good document, and there's a lot of backing and support for it. We wish the same for the certification process, but I think we must go that route. I also think it's important to show some progress on it. If we spend a year or two establishing such a certification mechanism, something else will appear. As HAP and people in aid has now merged to look after the standard, and perhaps even SPEAR should have merged with them, and we would have three organizations merging and maybe one new for certification. I'm just saying perhaps an observation. So we need to keep the momentum. Otherwise, what will happen if there's nobody out there to certify? Then the new HAP and people at APE will have to reinvent certification and do it together with looking after the core humanitarian standards. Somebody might like that. I don't know. I have got no opinion on it. But I think it's a good thing to work with a certification, independent certification body. I also think we need to look at this industry. I had a discussion with my minister this morning very early before he went on national radio, and he said, how much money is spent in this sector? Well, UN appeals for $16 billion last in 2013. If you add the private funding, you get up to $22 billion. Do we perhaps owe ourselves to add a bit of professionalism or persuade everybody else that we live up to standards that will actually ensure that we deliver the best for those who are out there? I think yes. And as somebody in the panel said before, if we do not do it on our own, we run the risk of somebody coming and telling us in a big way one day what to do or not to do. So I think the good thing about this process, the standards and the certification proposal, it comes from you. And all you get from us as donors is a buy-in to help you on it. Now, my final words will be on the steps forward, because we need some convincing here also. What you've done here is actually great for the whole sector. It needs to be fed into the World Humanitarian Summit. Several of us talked about it with Gui today. Next week, Denmark, as the chair of the OCHA Donor Support Group, with more than 20 donors, we'll have a meeting in New York with focus on the World Humanitarian Summit. We will feed the results and takeaways from this meeting into that, so we ensure that at least 20 donors are enlightened about it and the UN system as well. I will also encourage every one of you to feed into the process of the World Humanitarian Summit. There's online consultation. You can feed in and give your views on standards and so on. So please do that. I think it's important. Then, of course, we have ECOSOC meetings next summer. But I also think if we're speeding up getting this roadmap right, there'll be a number of organizations that have certified or are in the process before the World Humanitarian Summit. And it will look really good. It will be add in a big way to that one leg of the World Humanitarian Summit that talks about effectiveness. These are my words on everything on standards and so on, and certification. Now I just want to say a few more words on a big thank you, because all of this would never have happened without the commitment of a lot of colleagues in this room. HAP, People in Aid, SPEAR, SCHR have done a great job. And together with Dan Church Aid, who helped us arrange this setting, I think we should all give them a big hand. And the last thing will only be that once we finish here, there should be a little refreshment outside. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm very glad to have this in my hand finally, even if it's only at the end of the day, because my colleagues back in London are watching this on the live stream, and all they've seen me contribute so far is eating a banana in front of this camera. So I am working, I am. So I've found it a really instructive and interesting and interactive day, and as we've heard, it's been full of celebration and usefully challenging as well. And there are lots of thank yous that I'd just like to make on behalf of Christine at Sphere, Kate at SCHR, and Marion at HAP. First of all, to Danida, who are working not just with words and actions, as they've just said, but also with money to help us put this on, and particularly with Miller, who's been helping us on the steering committee from Danida. So thank you to Danida. And as was mentioned, Dan Churchate have helped us with the logistics through Katya, who is going to stand up or not. And not to forget the volunteers and the others who've been working with us, Erin and the other ones. So thank you. The communications managers at HAP and People in Aid have been hugely busy preparing a lot of the work for this, getting the things printed, the banners done, and making sure that it was all set up yesterday. So Murray and Fiona, can you please take a huge round of applause for what you've contributed? And finally, Raj. Thank you not just for getting us through today, and it's been very well facilitated, and if we finish 10 minutes early, we can all do the airport trip. But you've been with us for a year working this through, and as he said earlier on, his role has been to ensure there's an objective side to the process which has ended up with the CHS. So thank you for a year's worth of work to you and to Paola, your partner, in that. Thanks to you. Come again. Safe journeys, everyone. Thank you very much indeed.